Okay, so I want to discuss some issue about supersymmetry in curved space, and the content of this paper and of this talk is based on this couple of papers that I wrote in collaboration with Alessandro Tomasiello, Dario Martelli, Davide Cassani, and my student Claudio Sclare. And there is some related result in this other paper by Cyber and collaborators. So let me go to the essentially, well, the things that I want to discuss here. There is a recent interest in a very basic question in supersymmetry. When and how you can take a conformal field theory, superconformal field theory, or a supersymmetric field theory, which is supersymmetric in flat space, and put it on curved space, maintaining some supersymmetry. So obviously we know how to do this in flat space, on Torai, and I think the first work on putting a supersymmetry theory on anti-de Sitter goes back to the 70s. But okay, so these are maximally symmetric spaces, so a more general analysis just started, actually started with this paper by Festuccia and Cyber that proposed a general method for studying this issue. And the reason why this is interesting, apart from curiosity, I would say that it's an interesting and fun question, is the fact that recently we learned how to put some supersymmetric field theories on curved space, and in addition to that, to compute some observable. For example, just to give a few examples, because there are a lot of literature on this, if you take a three-dimensional theory with n equal 2 supersymmetry, n equal 2 is the same as n equal 1 in four dimensions, and you put it on a three-sphere, you get an interesting partition function. This partition function has many curious properties. First of all, it scales with the number of colors in a very funny way, n to the 3 over 2 is a scaling which is famous because it's sort of prediction of the DSCFT correspondence that has been around for more than 10 years, and now people have found ways of computing something in field theory. And computing an n to the 3 over 2 is a non-trivial task because you typically expect a gauge theory should go like n square if n is the number of colors, not n to the 3 over 2. And in the literature, there are even a stranger number. There are 5 over 3 in other circumstances in three dimensions. And other interesting things about the very same function is that it's a candidate for an F-theorem. F-theorem is the same as C-theorem in two dimensions, A-theorem in four. Now, there has been progress, for example, in four dimensions, improving an A-theorem by Schwimmer and Komagowski. So there is a proposal for a proof of such a theorem in four dimensions. And this function has the property that decreases along a normalization group flow. So it counts the number of degrees of freedom of conformal field theory. In addition to that, it's a technical point, but it's important in supersymmetry, is also maximized at the XATAR symmetry of a conformal field theory. So it plays the role of what in four dimensions is the process of A maximization, another important tool in supersymmetric field theory. And there are also many other computations of people in various dimensions, 3, 4, 5, on spheres, around squash sphere, ellipsoid, and this type of things. Most of the motivation is in dimension different from 4, for example in 5 and eventually in 6, is to get some information on this elusive conformal field theory in 6 dimensions, the famous 2,0 conformal field theory that is a suggestion of string theory, but we don't know exactly how to compute things there, and there are relations for the AGT correspondence and this kind of things. So in the Euclidean space, there are many interesting things that one can compute on curved space, sphere or squash sphere, and there are other examples. So a natural question is, what is the general space where you can put a field theory and what kind of observable you can compute there? This is in the Euclidean, and obviously there is also the natural curiosity what happened in the Lorentzian case. In addition to this, there is also the fact that people have found other examples of spaces which is not exactly anti-de Sitter, but is is a regular space which is asymptotically anti-de-Sitter, but has the property that the boundary is curved. So this is the natural candidate for the dual of a formal field theory. And when there is some supersymmetry, the dual of a superconformal field theory on a curved space. Well, this is a situation that we know very well for anti-de-Sitter, and even for anti-de-Sitter, we know that according to coordinates that we choose, we can have different boundaries. So most of you probably knows that there are typically two set of coordinates on anti-de-Sitter that people use, the global coordinates and the Poincaré coordinates. In global coordinates, the boundary of anti-de-Sitter is a sphere times time, and instead, when you use Poincaré coordinates, you get just Minkowski. The two things are simply related by a conformal transformation, and since we are studying conformal field theory through anti-de-Sitter, this is not unexpected. Indeed, the point is that if the choice of coordinates that you do in the bulk may correspond just to a Valery scaling in the boundary. And from this point of view, in the sense we are happy, even if we want to discuss the point, when can I have a superconformal field theory on a space which is conformally equivalent to Minkowski, okay, the answer is simple. Well, you just do a conformal transformation, you bring every conformal flat space to flat space, and you can define your theory. So the question becomes interesting when the space is not conformally flat, maybe not even Einstein, well, like in various cases in the literature. And these are properly conformal field theory in curved space that, in principle, you should understand how to define and whether they preserve supersymmetry, because there is no way with a conformal transformation to relate them to field theory in flat space. And the point is that the recent interest related also to this computation that I shown you before have given an example where the space, for example, is a squashed sphere, and even, again, from the ADS-CFT correspondence, again, you can compute the behavior with a number of colors of your theory. So the question that I want to address then is this one. When I can define, essentially, we'll talk mostly about conformal field theory, and I discuss at the end the case of supersymmetric field theory. When I can define a conformal field theory on curves, on non-trivial curve space, preserving some supersymmetry. So let me address the question from the point of view of holography, which is actually how we study this problem. From the point of view of holography, again, what you want to study is a bulk space which is asymptotically anti-de-Sitter, with a boundary which is not flat nor conformally flat, but in general is a d-dimensional curve manifold. Now, the point is that I'm discussing supersymmetric theory, superconformal field theory, so I want just to keep in this analysis the universal object that you have. Certainly, you have a stress energy tensor in the field theory, so you need to include the metric in your analysis, and indeed you want to put it on a curved background. But in a superconformal field theory, for example, in four dimensions, with n equal one superconformal field theory in four dimensions, in addition to the metric, you also have an R-symmetry that is crucial for the superconformal algebra. So you always have also a conserved current corresponding to the R-symmetry or your conformal field theory. So in general, what I want to, and this is universal, you always have in all conformal field superconformal field theory. So I want to keep these modes, at least in the bulk, the metric, and the gauge field, which is dual to the R-symmetry. And indeed, what I want to study, and that's the point that gives me some freedom in finding supersymmetry theories, is a theory which is defined on curve space on the boundary, and is also some background field for the R-symmetry. From the point of view of the ADS-CFT correspondent, this means that you take a conformal field theory in flat space, you put it on a curve manifold, and you add this coupling. So you turn on a background field for the R-symmetry, and this is this explicit deformation of your Lagrangian. So this is the basic point. Then you can ask when you can have supersymmetry. From the point of view of the dual, you have to solve the Killing equation for the corresponding gauge supergravity, and if I just keep the metric and this universal vector, I just need to use the minimal gauge supergravity in the dimension I'm interested in. I will mostly focus on four dimension on the boundary, which means five dimension in the bulk. And basically, the structure of this transformation is very simple if you just include these modes. So you have a covariant derivative, you have a term proportional to gamma, and you have some curvature of your field. In most of this talk, if you see a nabla A, means that is a covariantized version of the covariant derivative with the gauge field included. So if you just study the solution of this equation near the boundary, because you want to see when what the constraint of boundary on the boundary theory, you discover that the spinor should behave in this way. You plug it back here, and you get this very simple equation. This involves two spinor of opposite chirality on the boundary, if I'm discussing the four-dimensional case. And obviously, this equation containing two spinor can be simplified if you just compute the gamma trace of the equation, because you can determine epsilon minus in terms of this other guy. And what you get is this equation. This equation is known as the conformal Killing equation, and is essentially what I want to study here. If you are not happy with this holographic description of the problem, you could even try to give a purely field theoretic description. And in field theory, you can use this trick. So if you have a conformal field theory, you can couple it to conformal supergravity by turning on the multiplet or the fields corresponding to conformal supergravity, metric, gravitino, and the vector. And obviously, the coupling is complicated. The neutral coupling is simply, well, I couple the stress energy tensor to the metric, their symmetry to a mu, and the fermionic part. Then, obviously, the completion of your Lagrangian. The point is that if you just consider these guys as background fields, a background field for the metric is essentially what you want to do, put the theory on curved space. A background field for their symmetry is what I want to introduce in general, because it's allowed by algebra, and they allow me to have many solutions. So I want to treat these guys as background fields. If I want a theory which is supersymmetric in this setting, the point is that what I need to put to zero is the variation of the gravitino in the theory. And the variation of the gravitino is very simple, and in conformal supergravity is simply this one. And this equation involves two different spinors, epsilon plus and epsilon minus, which are respectively epsilon plus A is the transformation corresponding to supersymmetry. Epsilon minus is the superconformal partner of supersymmetry. If you want the Q transformation and the S transformation of the superconformal group. Obviously, this equation here is exactly the same that I found from holography, not unexpectedly. So this is the final conclusion of this, let's say, introductive analysis is the following. The condition for preserving supersymmetry, if you have a superconformal field theory and you want to put it on curved space, is given by essentially the solution of this equation. If you find a manifold where you can find a spinor that solves this equation, you can define in a consistent way your conformal field theory on curved space. This is called a... For the moment, no. Minkowski or Euclidean is the same. Formally, is the same equation. And this equation is known as the conformal Killing equation. And so is why in a conformal field theory is actually, if I have to choose among the equation given in mathematics, is the one that I would pick up, because essentially, well, first of all, is conformal invariant. If you do a value rescaling of your metric and you do a rescaling of your spinor, you still have a solution. So it has been studied by mathematicians because it's conformal invariant. Actually, obviously, it's more complicated than the equation that we typically look that just involve the derivative, but not so much. You can think of this as essentially the projection of the covariant derivative on the spinor on the reducible component of spin 3-half. So essentially, you eliminate this equation as no gamma. The gamma trace of this equation is trivially zero. Okay? So this is the equation that I want to solve. And indeed, as I already mentioned, when there is no gauge field, this equation has been studied by mathematicians, and the solution has been classified. The solution are also known as twistors, and I've been studying since Penrose. There is the book of Penrose on Twistor, and essentially studying flat space the properties of the solution of this equation. And okay, so let me tell you what is the result for A equal to zero given by mathematicians. This apply essentially for four dimensions. In different dimensions, there is a slightly different classification, at least for the Lorentzian case. So, okay, I don't want to explain to you what is a Pfefferman metric in the Lorentzian case. It's a class of metric which has been classified. So let me focus on the Euclidean, which is simpler to explain. In the Euclidean, essentially, this is a result that goes back to Lichnerowitz. You can prove that you have a solution of this equation whenever, on a Weyl scale metric, you can find a solution of this much simpler equation, which is the standard Killing Spinor equation. So the solution of this is called a Killing Spinor. Nabla is equal gamma, essentially. Mu is a parameter that is then fixed. And the solution of these are known and classified and used very much in string theory, in compactification, and all this business. And actually, people know that to solve this equation is enough to go to the cone over the manifold that you are discussing, because on the cone, the Killing equation becomes the equation for a parallel spinor. So the cone over the object that you study has a parallel spinor, so it has restricted holonomies. So, for example, if you start with a three-dimensional theory, you go to the cone, which is a four-dimensional one, and you just have R4, essentially, modulo quotient that you can always do. Same in five, so life is almost trivial here. Things become more interesting in six because you have all Calabi-Yaus. The Calabi-Yaus are the spaces where you can find a parallel spinor. And if you go to dimension seven, these are the manifold with restricted holonomy are called G2 manifold. The base of this guy is, again, is very simple and most trivial in three and four dimension because these are just sphere. The best you can do is to take a quotient, but okay, you get a Lens space or a sphere divided by some discrete group. Because more, if you want, more complicated in five and six because these objects are known as Sasaki-Einstein manifold and nearly Kähler manifold. And again, all these guys has played a large role in string compactification in the last 10 years. Or quotient. So for example, if I want to study four dimensions, if I have no gauge field, well, the conclusion of this analysis is that, okay, there's just S4 and all the space which are conformally S4. So it's essentially, you have the conformally flat situation. But the interesting thing is that if you turn on a non-trivial gauge fields, then the solution are much, the set of solutions of this equation is much larger. And let me first give the summary and then some details on some of this case. So this is a summary of the result for A different from zero. So when you allow a non-trivial gauge field, the question when you have supersymmetry on the curve manifold is the following. In the Lorentzian signature, you just need to have a metric which has a null conformal Killing vector, essentially a solution of this equation. When lambda is equal to zero, this is an equation for a Killing vector. When lambda is different from zero, it's called a conformal Killing vector. And that's enough, so you can find a gauge field that solves all the constraint given by supersymmetry. Even in the Euclidean situation, the life is simple because all the complex manifolds are allowed and can support supersymmetry. I don't want to give you the technical detail, but just the idea, you see that here in this table I also mentioned some form, because typically in this game, since you don't want to deal with fermions, what you do is to say that a fermion at a given point in your manifold is defining also some structure on your manifold. So for example, taking bilinears of the spinors, you can define differential forms. And if you start in Lorentzian signature with a spinor of positive chirality, what you discover is that by taking bilinears, you can define a vector, so a one form if you want, and a complex two form. So in terms of a local frame on your manifold, given by four Wirbein in Lorentzian signature, this vector, which is null, is just, you can say that it is 0 minus E1. And then you can define the complex vector in the remaining two coordinates, and combined with Z, you can define the two-form. So this is essentially what the existence of a spinor tells you in terms of structure. So you can always define forms on the manifold whenever you have the spinor. So the point is that this is an equation for the nabla of the spinor, and not unexpectedly, the information on the nabla of the spinor can be replaced with information on the derivative of this differential form. So you transform this equation in a set of linear equations for some derivative of this guy, some derivative of omega, and the gauge field. And actually what happens is that in this case, if you do the computation, it's a bit of spin or algebra, you discover that the constraint that you get are these two. And if you count components, it works like that. Your original equation brings as 12 constraints, because you have a spinor in four dimensions, it's a two complex object. Then you take a covariant derivative, you multiply by four. So in general, this is eight complex number, so it would be 16 real condition. But then this equation has the gamma trace, which is trivial, so you have to remove some. And the right number is 6 complex of 12 real. And if you plug the forms, if you compute the derivative of the form, you discover that the 12 conditions that you have here can be reorganized in such a way. You can use four of them to determine your gauge field. There are four components in a gauge field in four dimensions. And the remaining eight give you the condition for the existence of a null conformal Killing vector. The fact that this guy is null is just algebra. So if you start with a spin of definite chirality, you construct this guy, which is automatically a null vector. So whenever you can find a solution of this equation, you can also find a real gauge field, and you can define, with this background field, a conformal field theory on this space. So if you want to see what is the form of the space-time where you can define your theory, you can choose coordinate. Essentially, well, modulo globalis, if you want really to study the global things, you have to be more careful, but locally, certainly, if you have a conformal Killing vector, so in a solution of this equation, you can rewrite this as the Lie derivative of the matrix equal the matrix times the constant. If you do a value rescaling, you can eliminate this guy. So you can always, with a value rescaling, map a conformal Killing vector into a simpler Killing vector. So a Killing vector means an isometry, so you can choose coordinates where this guy is just derivative of a coordinate, and the point that the metric that you get is simply something like that. So this tells you that this guy is a null Killing vector. You can put an arbitrary two metric here, various one form. The point is that you want that y is an isometry, so nothing should depend on y. And you can give a very explicit formula, which I haven't written because they are long and boring, but they are very explicit, for the gauge field. So this, the gauge field that you turn on is just fixed by the form of the metric. Briefly, what happens in the Euclidean, and why Euclidean is different? Well, it's just a matter of spinor. Obviously, a spinor in Lorentzian and the spinor in the Euclidean, different properties. For example, the complex conjugate of spinor in the Lorentzian signature has opposite chirality. The complex of spinor in Euclidean has the same chirality of the original one. And in terms of form, this is reflected by the fact that if you take bilinears, you get something different. Actually, here you get two different two forms. And in terms of a frame, these are very simple phase, because this is J, which is just what is called usually the fundamental form on your manifold. And then you have a complex form, which suggests an almost complex structure on your manifold. And again, the condition that you find here are translated in linear condition for the derivative of these guys and the gauge field. So explicit here, I can even give you the form of the gauge field, because computationally slightly simpler, and the point is that, again, what you get from the conformal Killing spinor is a set of equations that determines the gauge field and some geometric constraint. Here, the geometric constraint can be written simply if you take the derivative of these two forms, and you can, in general, parameterize saying that the derivative of these guys is itself time and one form, and these guys can be written in this way, And the point what you get from your computation that this guy should be absent. If you look, it's not difficult to see that this is equivalent to the manifold is complex. Okay, it's an equivalent way of checking the complexity of the mode of your manifold. In terms of the derivative of this guy, you get two other objects, W4 and W5. You plug in here, and you get your gauge field. B is just the normal of your spinner. So this is an explicit solution. Notice an important thing is that this guy is complex, because this is not the complex conjugate of this. So the question is if this is allowed. Well, we are in the Euclidean, so why not? Supersymmetry still close if you take a complex background field. So from the point of supersymmetry, there is no problem. Since you are in the Euclidean, typically is what happens. Several fields become complex when you do the analytic continuation. So in principle, there is no problem with unitarity. So if you allow to turn on a complex gauge field, you can always solve this equation for all complex manifold. And actually, let me just give you a few examples, the very simple one. So all the Kähler manifold support supersymmetry. Not all the manifold are Kähler. Yes. Well, this has been complexified in a sense. I think, well, the point here is that if this is the correct. So, signature, yes. So what I want to do is to have a coupling to gravity such that this is the variation of the gravity. Now, if it is that, then I'm in the right equation. And I think in all the cases that I checked, this is the right. So there are even explicit construction of the Euclidean continuation of various supergravity. Their symmetry, no, here becomes essentially, you see, their symmetry, if you look at this equation, you can do two different things. Clearly there is a U1, okay? But then if you allow A to be complex, you can also get rid of the norm of the spinner. So it's a complexified asymmetry. But from the point of view of this equation, there are both. Clearly, if you want really to define the coupling to superconformal gravity, adding also the gravitational part of the story, probably things are more complicated. But I want to look at all these guys as background fields. So what I just need to solve is this equation. And indeed, yeah, there is a, well, in a sense, yes, it's non-compact because the full asymmetry is, so you can also eliminate the norm of the spinner using the gauge field. And indeed, the solution is this. It's the dilatation, yes, exactly. So you're gauging also the dilatation. Okay, so other example, very stupid. There are also many manifolds which are complex but not Kähler. And perhaps the simplest example is S3 × S1. Is one of the canonical examples. And it's also interesting in field theory because putting a conformal field theory on S3 × S1 is actually the same as computing the superconformal index of the theory. So this is an example that people use systematically, typically even without writing the Lagrangian because there are other ways of computing the superconformal index. And indeed, if you solve the equation, you will discover that your gauge field is complex because it's supported on the circle, but is purely imaginary. And just a subtlety, because I was lying a bit about global issues, I start and say that without gauge field, only manifold that you can have is S4, and you should jump up and say S4 is not complex, so there is no integrable complex structure. Actually, my analysis, unfortunately, I'm not Lichnerowitz, so my analysis up to now is just local. This equation is, the condition is locally equivalent to the existence of a complex structure, in the sense that whenever your spinner vanishes, all the forms that you find are ill-defined. So at the point where the spinner is vanishing, you can have global issues. But if you look at the sphere, obviously, so for example, if you take this, the standard Killing spinner on the sphere, and you decompose in positive and negative chirality, you will discover that both of these guys vanishes. For example, epsilon plus vanishes at the north pole, epsilon minus at the south pole. So if you remove the north pole, well, the sphere becomes R4, which is obviously complex. In general, so if you have a manifold which is complex, you can put supersymmetry. Then, if you have a manifold which is complex outside a certain number of points, in principle you can, but you have to check what happens as the point where the manifold is not complex. And S4 is a case where you can find a solution. Oh, let me mention now. So I discuss conformal field theories up now. Because this was the original motivation for our work. But essentially, without many effort, you can get results also for generic supersymmetric theory that you want to put on curve space. Actually, the argument is similar to what I did and was first given by Cyber and Festuccia, and they say, okay, take your theory, coupled now to Poincaré supergravity, it's not no more conformal, it's a generic theory, supersymmetric theory, and set the variation of the gravitino equal to zero. Turn on all the possible background field for asymmetry, background auxiliary field wave, and so on, and solve the equation. So if you have a theory with an asymmetry, you can couple to what is known as the new minimal supergravity in literature, and is a supergravity which contains obviously the graviton, the gravitino, and so on, and it has a gauge field, a mu, and this also has an auxiliary field, which here is called d mu. And if you look at the variation of the gravitino, you get an equation like that, which is slightly different from the previous one. So from the point of view of studying what space supports supersymmetry, now you should say, okay, I take this equation, I do the same analysis, I solve the constraint, and I see what happens. Well, it so happens that this equation is formally different from the conformal Killing equation, but not so different because with a simple trick you can map one into the other. So the point is that here you have an equation which contains on both sides the derivative. But suppose that you say, okay, I have my spinor, I take the gamma mu, nabla mu of the spinor, and okay, I don't know what this guy is, but I can always define a vector such that this can be written as the same spinor multiplied by v slash, which means v mu, gamma mu. But that's simply because gamma mu, essentially, gamma mu times a spinor is a basis for all the spinor in the world. So this is just pure algebra. You can always find a v that is just a definition. Define v in such a way. And then if you do this, you plug here, you do some gamma matrix algebra, you discover that this guy transform into this. You have to redefine a bit this guy. I call it small a. It's related to capital A by just a shift. So formally, the two equations are the same. So I can take the same result that I already studied. So and if I want to couple a supersymmetric theory to new minimal gravity, new minimal supergravity, and I want to preserve supersymmetry, so if what I want to do is turn on some background fields for this object and have supersymmetry, well, the result is, again, the same. If you are in the Euclidean, it's better that your manifold is complex, and if you are in the Lorentzian, you should have a null Killing vector. Actually, there are a few subtleties that I don't have time to explain, but just to enforce some condition on these guys, the fact that it's real and satisfy some extra condition given by supersymmetry, you should do essentially a virus scaling, and your original conformal Killing vector becomes a Killing vector, which is even simpler. Okay? So the conditions are the same. And probably supergravity people recognize what I did because what I did is, in the literature, many supergravity have been found by first using the superconformal, gauging the superconformal algebra, and then doing a gauge fixing to break the superconformal algebra to the Poincaré superalgebra. This is the language of conformal compensator, and if you look at the literature, essentially what I do here is just precisely the gauge fixings that, starting with matter coupled to matter where you gauge the superconformal algebra, you do a gauge fixing corresponding to the new minimal supergravity. Okay, in the last 10 minutes, let me go back briefly to holography. I started with holography, so maybe we want to know if the analysis that I found on the boundary is the same that I find in bulk, and if there is something more to learn. Well, essentially, so if I now want the dual of the theory that I construct, I should find a metric in the bulk of this form, which solves the full supergravity condition in the bulk. So now these are equations in five dimensions, okay? So the point is that actually, in the last 10 years, people classify this kind of solution, at least in the Lorentzian case. I don't want to discuss Euclidean because I actually not sure in general how to do the possible computation in Euclidean, because I say that in Euclidean on the boundary I kept a general complex field, so I should find a way of defining the supergravity in the bulk with a complex. So if you look at the literature, people are studying various analytic continuation from Lorentzian to Euclidean of gauge supergravity. Typically they decide that the original gauge field goes to a purely real or purely imaginary gauge field in the Euclidean. So you have some freedom with eyes. I don't know in general how do you get a full complex gauge field in the bulk in such a way that your equation of motion are consistent with a real metric, because I can take the gauge field to be complex, but it's better that the metric is real, otherwise the theory is obviously not well defined. So I mostly discuss the Lorentzian case. In the Euclidean, people, I think, are trying to generalize the supergravity in the bulk again. And so the step is even before that of classifying solution. But in the Lorentzian case, all solutions are classified, because people have classified all the BPS, all the one-half BPS of various supergravities. And for example, in the Lorentzian case in five dimensions, there is a full classification. And again, the classification requires some killing vector in the bulk. At first look, you say, okay, there is something that goes wrong, because this killing vector can be null or time-like. And I told you, okay, the crucial condition for supersymmetry in the boundary is to have a null killing vector. And there are other constraints. For example, for V time-like, the metric must be a time-like vibration of a Keller manifold. And for V null, okay, there is a specific form of the metric. So there are more conditions, apparently, there are more conditions in the bulk than what you get on the boundary. But actually, what you can show is that, no, the content is absolutely the same. And even when this field in the bulk is time-like, well, the supersymmetry is such that reorganizes itself in a nice way on the boundary. So for example, even anti-de Sitter is a bit tricky if you want to look at it from the point of view of the bulk, because anti-de Sitter is certainly supersymmetric. So this guy tells you that it should be a time-like vibration over a Keller manifold. If you look at anti-de Sitter in global coordinates, it doesn't really look like a time-like vibration over a Keller manifold, but with a simple trick, just take an angular coordinate on the sphere and shift it with a term proportional to time. So essentially, in terms of the usual left invariant form, what you are doing is taking sigma 3 and sending in sigma 3 minus dt. Well, the final form of the metric is this one, which is a time-like vibration over something that you can check is actually a Keller manifold. And what happened is that this guy is dual to the killing vector, so t is the killing coordinates, is time, and if you look at the behavior near the boundary, actually the t drops, and you get something which goes like r squared times something, which is this d, which is null. And indeed, this is a general situation. What you can show is that essentially all this condition of supersymmetry in the bulk reduce asymptotically to what we found on the boundary. So there is no, as expected, but it was not trivial to show, there's no new condition coming from the holographic picture. And in principle, you can do the following. Given a boundary matrix with a null conformal killing vector, which solves asymptotically your equation of supersymmetry, you can start constructing the solution in the bulk order by order in 1 over r, you can always do this. Obviously, so there is always a solution in the bulk corresponding to your theory. Well, the big and open problem in most of the application of a DSCFT to the physics of the gauge theory is when you can find a regular metric in the bulk. So we know, for example, that even without putting theory on curve space, we just want deformation and other things. So studying not complete theory, but theories with masses. The problem is that, well, you can deform your original correspondence, but you get singular metric in the bulk. There are very few examples of completely regular metric which are full dual of this. And in this game, there are a few examples. I will not discuss the detail of all of that, but for example, as I told you at the very beginning, you can do things with squash sphere on the boundary. And there are also some Lorentzian examples. But I think my time is running out, so let me conclude with this just two simple observations. Well, apart from the last one, which tells you that, okay, so this is interesting for holography in the sense that you have many new backgrounds. There are two interesting questions here. Once you have classified all the manifold which support supersymmetry, the interesting question is what kind of observable you can compute. Actually, there are many papers in the literature, and even just using squash sphere, you can make interesting connection with AGT, for example, and introducing new parameters. So the question is what really you can compute and learn. And another interesting thing is, and this is where people are, the reason why people are now studying five sphere, squash five sphere, and so on, is that it's also interesting, it would be interesting to know what are the conditions in five and six dimensions, which are interesting because of the existence of this 2,0 theory. Again, the 2,0 theory is predicted from the point of view of the SFT correspondence. We know that as a free energy, we scale like the number of color to the cube, which would be interesting to find in purely field theoretical method, but we don't know much about this. So maybe finding the right space where you can find it and compute, it would give us more information. So I think this is.
One very basic question: what do you mean by supersymmetry? Because do you have only one?
If there is a superalgebra. Or
no, but I mean, if you have two charges, like Q and Q bar, you can commute them, anti-commute them, and then you'll get a time-like Killing vector, right?
That's in this case, you get the null.
Okay, but I thought that actually, when you commute Q and Q bar, when you take the anti-commutator, you always get a time-like vector because of the properties of spinors. So, do you have one or two charges?
This question, and okay. Then I did a computation. Maybe yeah. I did wrong, but I get the null Killing vector. So, so here I have. The point is that this is invariant under. So, actually, you always have two spinors, not one, because you can always rotate it. Okay, mm-hmm. So the minimal number is two. So when? Lambda is the lambda that. So this z is null Killing vector. Well, when lambda is zero is a Killing vector. Let's take the simple. When lambda is zero is a Killing vector. Otherwise, it's a conformal.
When lambda is zero
is a Killing vector.
Yes.
Otherwise, it's a conformal Killing vector.
Yeah, but you say null Killing vector.
It's always null.
Ah, okay.
It's always null. So that's algebra. Okay, and that's why I say, well, you could never get starting with something which is. So the point is that spinors. What spinor tells you that is the only vector that you can construct with a spinor is null. Okay, so that's the reason why. If your objection is about property of spinors, I cannot agree. Okay, so the only vector you can construct is null by construction. Essentially, yes, because this equation and even the equation for new minimal, even this one is obviously invariant under U1. It's always relating epsilon plus to epsilon. So it's always, you always have a one for bonus. This is the same in Minkowski or in the Euclidean. In this case, people have explicitly constructed Lagrangian, which is invariant under the transformation when these guys are background fields. So I think it's consistent, at least formally, the Lagrangian is supersymmetric.
More questions? If not, we thank Alberto again.